Good evening, everyone. My name is Troy Sherman. I am the founder and managing editor of Politicus Journal. And thank you all for coming out tonight to our third public lecture put on by Politicus. The topic of tonight's debate is dirty laundry, scandal in the world of Canadian politics. And we have four fantastic panelists who will be joining us this evening. So I'm just going to talk. Oh, also, by the way, QTV is filming this and it will be recorded and put online. So if you have any issues with being filmed for this event, please let us know and we'll make sure that we'll figure something out later on. So if the two people are there and there, please come talk to me at the end of the lecture if you do not want to be featured in the video itself. So I will start off with introducing our four panelists and our moderator for this evening. So first we have Professor Goodyear-Grant. Elizabeth Goodyear-Grant is an associate professor of political studies at Queen's University. Her research focuses on Canadian and comparative politics, with particular interest in electoral politics, news media, and the political representation of women. She is the author of Gendered News, Media Coverage of Electoral Politics in Canada. In Gendered News, Professor Goodyear-Grant presents compelling evidence that gender structures certain aspects of news coverage of candidates and politicians, not how much they're covered, but certainly how they're covered, and demonstrates that these differences can impact negatively on female candidates and leaders' electoral prospects and political careers, contributing to the persistent underrepresentation of women at all levels of politics. Professor Goodyear-Grant's work has also appeared in venues such as Politics and Gender, Electoral Studies, Commonwealth and Comparative Politics, and the Canadian Journal of Political Science. In the Department of Political Studies at Queen's, Professor Goodyear-Grant teaches courses on campaigns and elections, women, gender and politics, Canadian politics more generally, and empirical methods. So thank you very much, Professor Goodyear-Grant, for being here tonight. Our second professor on the panel is one that many of you guys will know. It's Professor Jonathan Rose, who studied at the University of Toronto and Queen's, where he received his PhD. In addition to Queen's, he has taught courses at the International Studies Centre in the UK, Charles University in Prague, Bratislava, Slovakia, and Osaka in Japan, where he was a visiting professor of Canadian Studies. In 2008, Professor Rose was a visiting research fellow in the School of Political Science and International Relations at Victoria University of Wellington in New Zealand. He is the author of Making Pictures in Our Heads, Government Advertising in Canada. He's also the co-editor of Canada, the State of the Federation, 1998, and is the lead author of First Minister's Conference, The Art of Negotiation, a simulation exercise published by Broadview Press and translated into three languages. His most recent book, co-written with Patrick Fournier, Hank Van Der Kolk, and R. Kenneth Carty, is Where Citizens Decide, Lessons from Citizens' Assemblies on Electoral Reform. Professor Rose's teaching is varied. He has taught graduate and undergraduate courses in Canadian politics, political communication, federalism, the mass media, electoral systems, intergovernmental relations, and public policy. In 2010, he received the Frank Knox Certificate of Commendation for Excellence in Teaching. In 2011, Professor Rose was the recipient of the W.J. Barnes Teaching Excellence Award. He has provided advice to the Auditor General of Canada on government and advertising and sponsorship, and is a member of the Advertising Review Board for the Auditor General of Ontario, a board that enforces legislation regulating government advertising in Ontario. In 2006, he had the privilege of being an academic director of the Ontario Citizens Assembly on Electoral Reform, the first such body in Ontario and second in the world. So thank you very much, Professor, for being on this panel tonight. Our third panelist is a very special guest who's come in from Ottawa this evening. So Adrian Harewood is anchor of CBC's local weekday supper hour television newscast, CBC News Ottawa at 5, 5.30, and 6, and anchor CBC News late night, seen at 11 p.m. on weekdays. Adrian grew up in Ottawa's West End and attended elementary and high school at Ottawa's Ashbury College. He studied political theory and history at McGill University, where he is also station manager of the campus radio station, CKUT. Before coming to television, Adrian was the host of the number one rated All in a Day on CBC Radio 1 in Ottawa. He has been a guest host on national CBC programming, including As It Happens, Sounds Like Canada, and The Current. Adrian has a keen interest in community involvement. He spends hundreds of hours every year at events in Ottawa and the surrounding area. So thank you very much, Adrian, for being here tonight. Our final panelist is an undergraduate student, seeing as Politicus is focusing on undergraduate research on political and international affairs. Taylor Mann is a fourth-year political studies student who has branched out into the world of advertising and public relations. After working for Rogers Wireless doing social media strategy, he discovered a passion for digital communication during the following year. He worked full-time as a communications officer for the Alma Mater Society, after which he became a digital strategy intern in the Toronto-based advertising agency, John Street. In his spare time, Taylor authors a blog on his personal website and does freelance design work and PR work. Thanks a lot, Taylor, for being here tonight. And finally, we have our moderator this evening, one of our very own. Stephen Patterson is a second-year political studies student here at Queen's. His political involvement on campus includes working as a second-year representative to the Politics Department Student Council and serving on the editorial board of Politicus. Canadian politics is his area of interest, so he is particularly excited to be a part of this event and honored to be included with such esteemed panelists this evening. This lecture is an opportunity to address the very nature of political scandal and for thoughtful discussion on some of the most compelling and controversial news stories that have caught Canadians' attention this past year. So thank you very much, Stephen, for being our moderator this evening. So before we begin and I pass it off to Stephen, I also want to recognize and thank the Arts and Science Undergraduate Society for their continued financial and resource support. I also want to thank the Office of Vice Principal Research who has helped us get started and lifted off this year. So thank you very much to all those who have helped and to our panelists and our moderator this evening. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. I think I have the shortest resume of everybody, but I'm really honored to be here, really happy. As you all know, it's my job as moderator to break the ice, so I'm going to do that really quickly. I told all the panelists I would. So I'm going to tell a little story. In the House one day, a member rose up, you know, in the middle of a debate and said, "You know what, Mr. Speaker, half the members in this House are corrupt." And everyone just, of course, everyone just freaked out. Everyone was really, really upset. Everyone got really angry. He said, "All right, you know, Mr. Speaker, I'd like to take back my previous comment. Half the members of this House are not corrupt." Okay, so now that the ice is broken, I'm going to quickly explain the format. And then we'll get into the debate and you guys can hear from them. It should be more interesting. Okay, so the format for the debate, we're going to start off with all the panelists giving a 3-minute introductory remark. Just kind of staking where they stand in this debate and giving us a little bit of perspective of where they're coming from. So that'll be 3 minutes. And then after that, we'll get into the question portion, the moderated debate portion. So I'm going to ask a question to each of the panelists. I'm going to ask one question for all the panelists. Each of the panelists will have 2 minutes to respond. After that point, I'm going to encourage the panelists to engage with each other to make my job nice and easy. But if need be, I'll interject and ask a follow-up question or try to stimulate a conversation that I think might be interesting. Then after that portion, after I ask 4 of those questions, we'll get into you guys. You guys can ask some questions to our great panelists. Okay, so without further ado, I'm going to invite Professor Rose to give the first introductory remark.
Excellent. Well, you stole my first story. I was going to tell that very awesome story, but I guess I can't. So thank you very much for organizing this, and thank you all for coming. You know, I woke up this morning and I looked out my window and saw all the snow, and I was convinced it would either be just my colleagues and I sitting here talking to no one or just a few people, so I'm thrilled everyone's here. And also thanks to Adrian for coming such a long distance. Appreciate that. So I've had fun thinking about what a political scandal is, because it's given me reasons to go back and look at some salacious political stories through the era. And when you think about it, they all involve the same sorts of things. They're all about moral transgressions. So the first thing we can think about is all political scandals are about moral transgressions. So there's an assumption there that all political actors have free will, they make choices, and sometimes those choices are flawed. The other thing that political scandals involve is something about the relationship between power and our private lives. And here I went back and I dug into a book, which is really quite ancient, but it's a great book, by Cicela Bock, called Secrets. And in that book, she talks about the importance of secrets in distinguishing this private, public part of our lives. And that's the other element of a scandal. It's not a scandal unless someone knows about it. So there are plenty, and Adrian probably knows more about this than any of us up here, plenty of stories on the Hill and floating around in Ottawa that aren't scandals. And they're not scandals because the purview of people who know about it aren't that big. So in Canada, we have had scandals. I mean, most recently, we're all consumed with Rob Ford. But when you think about it, there have been scandals related to sex. Gerda Munsinger is the most famous one. In Prime Minister John Diefenbaker's cabinet, a minister sleeping with an East German spy. Bob Coates in Mulroney's cabinet, going to a strip joint in Lahr, West Germany as a minister of defense. We've had, so to say the Canadians are boring is a bit understatement. We've had, you know, nothing like what's happening in France with François Hollande and his mistress. Nothing like that, although it's known that prime ministers through the era had mistresses. We've had money. Of course, the Airbus scandal is huge. The Senate scandal, of course, is huge. All of that involves money. And I wanted to talk later, when we get an opportunity to do so, about the second order scandal. Because these scandals don't exist on their own. They exist through the media. And I hope that's what we're going to get into. Is that my cue to shut up?
No, that's your cue for 30 seconds.
Okay, 30 seconds. So let me just say, I hope to get into some of the more substantive aspects of scandals. But what I wanted to leave you with is that all of them involve moral transgressions. And maybe we can think through what those transgressions are. Thanks.
I'd never tell you to shut up. Adrian.
You should.
Okay, that's a hard act to follow. But first of all, thanks so much for inviting me to come. This morning, last time I was in Kingston for more than a day was about 20 years ago. I used to work at a place called the Kingston Global Community Center, and this place really helped to shape me. So I'm really pleased to be back here. I'm also surprised that I'm amongst Golden Gales. I went to McGill, and I played on the soccer team, and we didn't like Queens that much. So it's pretty shocking to me to have this opportunity to speak with you this evening. Let me get to the core of my argument, and I'm going to read part of this. In a column entitled A Disheartening Year in Canadian Politics, written by Jeffrey Simpson on December 20th, 2013, Jeffrey Simpson, of course, is a Queen's alumnus. He's a longtime columnist for the Globe and Mail, and he called 2013 an annus horribilis for those who care about Canadian politics. He said, quote, "Scandals, corruption, and buffoonery too often dominated the news, causing even more Canadians to get mad, disillusioned, or turned off their public affairs. How could at least some of them not feel this way?" he said. "Too much of political life was besmirched by dishonorable, even disgraceful behavior." Now, Simpson pointed to the tsunami of scandals that seemed to have overwhelmed the Canadian landscape over the last 12 months. The Rob Ford saga, the Charbonneau Commission in Quebec, and the muck of Quebec's mafia-infested construction industry, and the gangster-ridden municipal politics in Quebec. He talked about the Senate expenses scandal, and of course, Ontario's gas-fired power plant saga and cover-up. Now, the column was to kind of reference George Grant, a lament for the Canadian nation, a nation that, according to Simpson, has lost its bearings and become dangerously unmoored, a nation fed up with politics and politicians. It's as if Simpson perhaps believes that we were once led by better people, that the political elites who once ruled us were exemplars of probity, competence, and good manners. Well, suffice it to say, I'm not persuaded by Jeffrey Simpson's argument. In fact, I take the opposite point of view. There is too little scandal coverage in Canadian newspapers and on television stations and on radio as well. We need more scandal coverage, not less. I say, bring it on. Now, when I use the term scandal, I use the definition offered by George Washington University professor Robert Entman, author of Scandal and Silence, Media Responses to Presidential Misconduct. And Entman defines scandal, I have 30 seconds, okay, so I'm going to have to kind of quickly wrap it up. But Entman defines scandal as when the media publicize misconduct by public officials and treat that misconduct as an urgent problem that has to be thoroughly investigated and remedied by holding someone accountable. Really, very, very quickly, there's nothing particularly new or modern about scandal. The biggest scandal monger in Greece was who? Socrates. Right? Socrates was a scandal monger, was he not? Right? He was. Canada's first great political scandal was the Great Pacific Railway scandal of 1873. You know, Sir John A. Macdonald, the favorite son of Kingston, was turfed out of office. Right? He was out of office for 5 years. He only got back in 1878, right, because of that scandal. So there's nothing particularly unique or horrible about the year 2013, and I'll kind of get into that a little bit more. but thanks for that.
Thank you. Professor Goodyear-Grant.
Thanks very much. So in terms of an opening statement, I mean, I don't know that I have a position on scandal, except that in some cases, when scandal is the result of corruption, I'm against it. But one thing I'm going to say tonight through various forms of discussion, and you know, Jonathan and Adrian have also sort of edged towards this point, is that not all scandal, in my view, is actually the public's business, right? So a lot of scandal has to do with the private lives of individuals that we elect to office. You know, and people who are guilty of moral transgressions, for sure, probably, like adultery, drug use, alcohol abuse, whatever, there could be instances where their actions affect their role in office and thereby concern us all. But there's lots of cases where scandal has erupted as the result of a politician's actions, which are sort of, you know, moral transgressions, which I don't believe have actually affected his or her role in public office. And so in that sense, my view is that it's none of the public's business. So I guess I would maybe sort of disagree with you that we need more scandal coverage. I think it depends what the scandal is. So there's my first point, and it's probably my most important point about scandal. We use terms like corruption, scandal, political ethics, and so on interchangeably, but they're not the same. Right? Corruption to me is about some wrongdoing, some breaching of law, regulation, or policy by a government official, usually as a result of the use of public office for personal gain. So things like the Airbus scandal, the sponsorship scandal, and so on would be good examples of corruption. Scandal, though, is a much bigger umbrella, right? And it involves things like sex scandals, drug use, alcohol use, other forms of personal vice. And I'm not convinced that all of those are fit for public consumption or are relevant to people's actions in office. So I want more clarity around the use of the word scandal. I want the public to be more aware of when scandal is and is not its business. And I also am more interested as a political scientist, I mean, as a private citizen, I'm judging, just like all of us are judging. But as a political scientist, I'm really interested in the causes of scandal, the context in which scandal and corruption become more or less likely, as well as why people who self-select into political office seem particularly prone to this kind of behavior. Thanks.
Thank you. Taylor, please.
So I'm along sort of the same lines. I don't really have an opening statement per se, but I would say that on sort of the broad thrust of what we're talking about here today, before the panel, I posted on Facebook asking people for their thoughts, but I also just asked a bunch of people who I worked with, who I walked to work with, friends I saw around the Queen's Center today, what they thought of the state of Canadian politics cynicism. Probably half of them said, "I don't pay attention to that crap." And then kind of like the conversation realistically ended there. The other three quarters were like, "You mean Rob Ford and that kind of stuff?" And I'm like, just kind of nod my head, was like, "Yeah, that's what I mean." And then probably like 5% mentioned an in-depth, more political scandal along the lines of what Dr. Goodyear-Grant just said. And so first of all, I would say that even just on my day-to-day interactions and also just like with my experience in the world, I would say that there is a level of cynicism about politics in Canada and about scandal and the level of scandal, like what we hold our leaders to account to. And we're going to get into this in the first question, I believe. But that's something I'm really interested in talking about tonight. But I also think that what I'm really interested in talking about tonight is sort of the role that the internet's going to play in this, and specifically the rise of the rise of what you're going to talk like clickbait. We've all obviously heard the word clickbait before, but there's a new term coming to prominence in the media world called quickbait. And it's not just about creating something that people are going to click on, but it's about creating something that you're going to be able to put together quickly, and that people are going to be able to read, consume, and then share with their friends quickly. So what happens when we get into that sort of soundbite culture and the sort of the shareable blog post read in 2 minutes? What does that have our effect, not only on our understanding, but also on our attention span to what we have in politics? Because like we talk a lot about the sensationalism of things like Rob Ford, the Senate scandal, that kind of stuff. the Rob Ford scandal brings up a lot of really important questions about how people should be able to remove people from political office. I agree to some degree with Dr. Goodyear-Grant that some things aren't the purview of the Canadian public and our politicians, and we tend to, I think, delve a little bit too much into political personal lives. But when the mayor of Toronto is becoming inebriated and is actively being hard on crime while then going out and using crack cocaine, where is that line? But those aren't the questions that are being asked, and those aren't the things that are usually being addressed, because we get into that sort of sensationalism, right? You don't look for what's important, even though there are important messages and conversations to be had. And secondly, I'm really interested tonight in looking at what are the various parties' roles in this, because first of all, I think we as Canadians have to sort of take a little bit of ownership in terms of we like these stories. Like, Canadians like these things. We are a typically a very disinterested group who get interested and pay attention when something negative comes up. So I think we're partly to blame. But then I think also you have to look at the political leaders and the political parties and their role in building themselves up as perfect and not doing that. And I think there's some interesting discussion to be had about that, but that's sort of my broad view.
Great. All right, thank you. So I'm now going to get into the four questions. So each question will start with a nice little preamble, and then I'll get into the questions, and you guys will have to see the questions and some pictures and stuff on the screen, okay? So I'm going to start with a little preamble, and then we'll get right into it. In a recent McLean's article, John Geddes discusses how political scandal and corruption has come to be viewed and understood among Canadians. Citing the studies and observations of Michael Atkinson, the article states that there appears to exist a wide gulf between international norms and domestic attitudes. Despite the fact that Canada is consistently ranked among the least corrupt countries in the world, Canadians remain extremely cynical about the level of corruption that exists in Canada. Thus, the argument follows that Canadians have an overall jaundiced view of our politicians, and we expect corruptive practices. I'll put the question up here, and then I'll read it for our panelists. Do we in Canada have a different understanding of what corruption means? How would you say the response to scandal in Canada compares to other states or countries, for example, the U.S.? How would you say political scandal affects voter perception and engagement with Canadian politics? And then just as it so happens, we're going to start with Professor Rose again for this question.
Oh. Okay, great. There was a piece by Jeffrey York in the Globe and Mail about, and I think it was in the summer, about why the Rob Ford scandal was simmering and boiling, about why Canadian scandals really weren't scandalous at all. And he is a Globe columnist based in South Africa, and he was talking about real scandals. And he talked about the kind of things that would make your jaw drop in terms of bad behavior around financial issues, around personal issues, around integrity. And I think he's sort of right, that notwithstanding Rob Ford, which of course has skyrocketed Canada scandal central, we're not really a scandal-prone country. The difference between the Canadian and American case, I think, can be attributed in part to our political system. So in the American system, as you know, where the president is elected, there's much more emphasis on the individual characteristics of leadership. In Canada, with a parliamentary system, there's less emphasis of that, but of course the prime minister is seen as primus inter pares. But I think one of the reasons why there's a difference in Canadian and American scandals has a lot to do with our political system. The other has to do with the nature of the media, and I'm sure we'll get into that later, but the intense competition in the United States kind of foments a scandal that needs to be fed and needs to be continuous. So I think that's part of the issue.
Great, thank you, Professor Rose. Adrian, go ahead.
Well, I guess I don't think Canadians are any more or less scandal prone than anyone else. And I think that Canadians tend to have quite a heightened sense of themselves. And we tend to think that we are kind of above the fray, and that all of the terrible things happen south of the border or in some place in the global south, someplace in the third world. But I think the Charbonneau Commission really puts a lie to that, does it not? Right? Because it's a pretty sordid affair. It's a pretty mucky, nasty kind of thing that's going on right now at that commission, where it's been revealed that the kind of gangsterism that exists in various city halls in Montreal, in Quebec, not just Montreal, the extent to which the construction industry has been contaminated. I think we can use that term by the mafia. So I think Canadians are quite good at scandal. Maybe the problem is that we don't, as media, we're too cozy to power, we're too close to power, perhaps. And perhaps we haven't done a very, very good job of doing the kind of muckraking that I think is really required to reflect the country to itself. I want to kind of talk a little bit about just the political culture that exists in this country, because I think as we've become less class-based in our politics, I think scandal becomes more important. Because scandal becomes a way in which one can distinguish between parties that really have very little difference between them in terms of actual policy. So I actually think that scandal politics is becoming more and more important in Canada, because it enables Canadians to distinguish between which side they're going to support. Does that make any sense? Is that clear? Maybe I need to explain that a bit more. I think I've run out of time.
That's great, thank you. Professor Goodyear-Grant?
Thank you. So the sort of really interesting part of this question for me was the alleged gulf between Canadians' opinions and realities. So the idea is that Canada is one of the least corrupt nations in the world according to a variety of criteria. But Canadians still have this sense that corruption is all around us. I mean, I think part of it might have to do with what I was talking about in my opening statement, equating scandal with corruption, right? So measurement of corruption worldwide by places like Freedom House, Transparency International, and so on, actually look for, you know, overt rot in the political system. And it gets measured by things like, you know, politicians actually breaking rules around, say, claiming expenses or whatever. But as I was talking about previously, scandal is a whole lot bigger than that. So it could be that, you know, Canadians have this sense that corruption is rife because they're equating scandal with corruption and so on. Another point that sort of came immediately to my mind is that, well, that's not actually all that surprising, because the public is often wrong about lots of things, right? Compare crime statistics with perceptions of crime, which is actually quite analogous, you know, if we're talking about general crime versus political crime. You know, the public in Canada and the US and probably across the Western world has this sense that crime rates are rising and that there's danger all around them, when in fact, you know, all sorts of justice statistics point out that crime has been plummeting. Personal violent crime has been decreasing for years. So I guess one of the questions that is important to ask here is how the public comes to conclusions and based on what information about corruption, scandal, and other issues. And again, you know, we probably want to get into talking about media, but not only media, right? Like, to what extent are political parties and efforts to tarnish their rivals at play here?
Okay, great. Taylor?
Yeah, fantastic. I'm gonna start by just sort of going off of a thought that one of the last speakers mentioned. That's sort of like the actual system that we have and specifically the need to define yourself in opposition to something, and I think that's one of the big things at play here. I think that actually goes to both the first two speakers, and in terms of the system we have and the institutional differences that actually make this make scandal or the perception of scandal more widespread. And the reason I say that is first for two things. First of all, when Professor Rose says that we do take a less of a personal tack in politics, I think the reason that really plays into this is because when you look at Canadian politics, it's less about the person and it's more about the party. It's the Liberal Party wants to do this. The Conservative Party has delivered 8 years of strong economic growth. It's it's the parties typically and their leaders, but there's a very, very big party culture in Canada. And I think what a lot of that leads to in terms of us defining scandals more broadly is that it isn't just Mike Duffy and Stephen Harper and Nigel Wright that have a scandal. It's the Conservative Party, which is several hundred thousand people spanning across the country who are very strongly identified with that movement, many of whom are completely uncorrupt, had no idea that was happening, and are very good people. But the nature of party politics in Canada is that you lump those people into a group, and suddenly that group is corrupt. It's not the person, it's the group. And I think that's a big part of this, and sort of why we do it, and why it's different than the United States. And also, this is a bit of a facile thing too, but I think that Canadians, if you look at the Pew, I was looking at a Pew research poll before this in terms of how Canadians pay attention to Canadian political coverage versus American coverage. And while there is a lot of coverage of scandal in both areas, it is typically worse in other countries, and Canadians do tend to consume a lot of international political news as well. We don't tend to be overly interested in our own domestic politics, and I think that has a big thing here too.
Great. Okay, so now we'll kind of open up the floor for a couple minutes. Does anyone want to address anything any of the other speakers said or pick up on a point? Okay, I'm going to ask a follow-up question then. So something we kind of heard throughout the panel here is that the reason there's a difference, or the reason you can compare between countries, is the institutional political difference, right? And that was something too, I think, picked up on at the end. Is there any difference, do you think, in terms of perception, in terms of the people? Do we have a different standard for what constitutes a moral transgression? So how would we respond to a sex scandal in Canada? Is there any reason that that's different other than the political and institutional reasons? Anyone?
I don't think so. I mean, I think that, you know, we can only go so far in distinguishing ourselves from Americans. I mean, the two countries are so sort of enmeshed culturally that, I mean, I don't see any reason why there would be much difference in response on the whole. Maybe regionally, I suppose, if you compared, you know, a certain region in the U.S. with a certain region in Canada. But on the whole, I don't see why that would be the case. Like, I don't see Canadians as being any sort of more socially or morally conservative. If anything, parts of Canada are probably more socially or morally liberal than parts of the U.S. So that sort of doesn't really help us to understand then the claim why Canadians would feel that scandal is all around them more so than their American counterparts.
I think much has to do with the relationship between media and the kind of political potentates, I guess, in this country. You know, it's kind of interesting that you can name the number of really salacious, sordid affairs in Canadian political history on one hand.
Yeah.
Really. Like it's true. Maybe Maxime Bernier, that's mm-hmm. kind of salacious, I suppose. Munsinger mm-hmm. in the 60s. Bob Coates. Mm-hmm. Possibly Diefenbaker now. Like, Diefenbaker was truly the father of the nation,
son,
right?
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, he seems to have fathered a number of different kids, but they're not right. But we're only finding this out 40 years later, and so there's something to be said about, like, the question I have is, why do we not know more about the personal lives of some of our leading politicians? And I would argue that it's probably because there was a kind of a tacit agreement between media and the kind of politicians in the Senate, in the House of Commons, that certain things would not be said. Whereas in the United States, it seems as if there's a little bit more, or at least the media's had a little bit more latitude, perhaps, yeah, to speak out about these kinds of affairs.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, I completely agree. And I think one of the reasons for that difference is libel laws. And you mentioned briefly libel laws. And the First Amendment, I think, privileges and allows media to say things that Canadian media wouldn't say. And our relatively chilly libel laws, I think, are a self-censorship on Canadian media and what they do. I know a Globe and Mail reporter, Greg MacArthur, who was a graduate a few years ago, who broke the Mulroney story, the Mulroney Airbus story. And he was talked about how difficult it was to get past the editors, and how a series of lawyers had to vet the story, even though it was there was firm evidence to support it. He also said, you know, he had friends in the United States who said, you know, we could run this story and publish it if you don't. And that was one of the tipping points about why the Globe ran it. So that, to me, suggests other institutional reasons like our libel law.
Just to quickly add to that, Canada's very poor at prosecuting white-collar crime, yeah, as well. And I think there's a relationship there. Mm. Conrad Black had to go to the States,
right,
to go to jail, right? He didn't go to jail here, which is interesting. Yeah.
Okay, great. I'm going to move on to the next question here. So I'll start with the preamble. I'm just going to ask all the panelists if you guys can just speak up a little bit more. I think people at the back are having a little bit of a hard time hearing. And make sure the microphone picks it up. Get into the next one. So the next one has to do with the media, so it's a nice segue into it. I think that we can all agree that the media is a very... that's not Rob Ford. I think we can all agree that the media is a very powerful force in Canadian politics. If Rob Ford's crack video and subsequent antics are any indication, Canada can quickly become defined by how the media take to a particular scandal story. However, it has been argued that the Ford scandal has provided not only a much-needed distraction for Canadians from other political dysfunction, depending how we view ourselves and our political system and how the rest of the world perceives Canada. And the question is, how has Canadian news media shaped our view of corruption and scandal? How does the way in which Canadian political scandal is portrayed in the media play a role in shaping our national image? And to what extent is this role positive or negative? I'm going to start with Taylor on the far end.
Okay, cool. I think the other speakers also might sort of echo this, but I think that one of the big things here is that I think Canadians typically are, at least from my view, I'd be interested in hearing their thoughts, but I feel like Canadians have more of a passive interest in Canadian politics. Typically, it is hard to get Canadians engaged in political issues, and that's even just at the federal level. Go to provincial level, where two-thirds of services are delivered, and it gets even harder, which is kind of whack when you think about it. But I think that one of the big things here, and it goes more to the first part of the question, is that a big part of media, and again, I talked about this in my opening statement, and I think it's getting a bit worse now, is that the media, they do need stuff to report on, and they need a way to get people to pay attention. And a lot of big thing now is that when people do tune in, it's often for sort of bigger, more grandiose, or more what you'd say like juicy stories, right? So I think a way that the media, and I'm not just talking about the traditional media anymore, I'm talking about blogs, I'm talking about community websites, I'm talking about things that we wouldn't have considered like the Fifth Estate until a couple years ago. I think those things have a big way in shaping how we view scandal, simply because it's a way for them to get views, it's a way for them to get attention, and in a large part, I think they tend to be their own worst enemy in terms of distracting from more important scandals. Like, for instance, why did the Rob Ford thing take up 6 months of news coverage when there is, quite frankly, like there was a $1.1 billion power plant scandal at the provincial level the Canadians don't really seem to be all engaged with, even though that is going to affect them way more than a mayor who tends to go into drunken stupors. So I'm, yeah, that's sort of my view on that.
Great.
Professor
Goodyear-Grant.
Yeah, I mean, I'm right with you, actually. I mean, to the extent that the media plays a large role in defining what scandal is and in assigning importance to one type of scandal over another, media play a central role in our thinking about politics and political scandal. I mean, that's a really good example, actually. The obsessive attention to every detail of Rob Ford's daily movements, like, you know, tracking the guy outside of the elevator at his office, showing up at his house, you know, interest in every little detail. I mean, it's becoming excessive, right? I mean, we get it. The guy is, you know, a crackhead. He's an alcoholic. He's a sexual harasser. He's, you know, all these things. But you're right. I mean, there are other things going on in the province of Ontario, the city of Toronto, et cetera. You know, it was pointed out that one of the things that maybe we should be talking about is why procedures in municipal politics in Toronto are such that a mayor cannot be removed from office. So, I mean, we should be using these opportunities to talk about bigger, probably more important, more long-lasting issues in the political scene around us. How is all of this shaping our national image? I don't really know. I mean, scandal, as you've pointed out, Adrian, has always been there. It's, you know, from the very beginning, you know, big scandal, like kickbacks, hundreds of thousands of dollars in 1872 kickbacks. I mean, this is big scandal. It's always been with us, and it always will. I mean, it sort of goes to my earlier point that, you know, people who self-select into politics over history probably have a higher than average probability of reaching into the cookie jar. So what we need to focus on probably, and the media should help us out here, is in devising ways of ensuring this doesn't continue to happen.
Thank you. Professor Rose? Sorry, we're not going in order. We're jumping around.
Oh, we are? Okay.
Yes. Professor Rose.
Okay. Well, let me just step back and talk about the two big, what I think is the overlapping problem of scandal and media. So what do the media do? I mean, the media are about openness, transparency, and about communicating information. And what is at the heart of scandal? Power. And what's the nature of power? It's secretive, it's exclusive, and it doesn't want to be open and transparent. So, I mean, I think the reason why you have this collision between these two is because they're kind of in contestation. I think I might disagree with my panelists and say, as media become more pervasive and more prominent, there have been more scandals. It's not that people didn't behave badly in the old days, back in the day, of course they did. But what's become apparent now is this openness, this publicness, if you will, and this desire and demand by the media to make things transparent. And that's the variable that I think is different. I guess the other thing I wanted to say is we've also changed our notion of what politicians are. And I think as politicians have become much more about character and individual traits, what Kathleen Hall Jamieson calls the feminine style, which is that politicians now have to be revealing. They have to show their inner side. Can you imagine Winston Churchill doing the kinds of things that politicians now do, crying on TV, apologizing? They would have none of it. And I think that has created this kind of different expectation on the part of public about what they should be.
Thank you. Adrian.
You know, I think it's true to an extent that the mainstream media is interested in the pursuit of truth and also transparency. But I think the mainstream media is also interested in eyeballs.
Right.
And they're interested in your eyeballs. Because essentially, they're selling your eyeballs to advertisers. Right. And in order to sell to advertisers, you want to have a certain number of eyeballs watching you.
Mm-hmm.
And the truth of the matter is that a lot of these scandalous stories are kind of salacious and sexy, and they attract people. So there's a commercial dimension. Another aspect is that we now live in the 24-hour news cycle, and mainstream media needs to be fed each and every day. That's a lot of programming that needs to be filled.
Mm-hmm.
And oftentimes you will cover stories that are easy to cover.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, we need a lot more investigative journalism in Canada, and that requires money. It requires a lot of resources. It requires institutional support. And that's something that is sorely, I think, lacking in this country. And if we want if you want a media that's going to reveal more of the truth about our institutions, that requires a real investment of time and money. Just really, really quickly on the Rob Ford issue, I think Canadians feel kind of ambivalent about Rob Ford. I think we've gone through a couple of different stages in this story. Initially, we thought it was funny and kind of weird and odd. And then we were kind of titillated and excited that Americans were paying attention to this guy.
Right.
Right? Because in some ways, it kind of validated us. Like, it made us feel more worthwhile. It made us feel, like, finally, because Americans often look at Canadians with indifference, right? They don't really pay attention. But now, our mayor is the most famous mayor in the world, right? And Jimmy Kimmel is talking about him every single day or every single night. Like, there's something kind of exciting about that. I think now, though, we're at the stage where we're kind of, a lot of people are kind of embarrassed and kind of disgusted by it. Anyway, those are the three stages of Rob Ford.
Taylor,
sorry for
we have
time.
No, that's okay. We have 2 minutes, so whoever wants to.
Okay. Yeah, I think that brings up an interesting question too, in terms of the question of sort of now who is the media, right? And I think that's kind of where we're going in terms of a big open question mark, because. Well, first of all, a couple of things. I mean, I have a friend who works in the press office for the Premier, and she was saying that they're having, even just on a policy standpoint, they're now having a really tough time defining who gets media access, who is defined as media, even just on a purely technical standpoint, because the Torontoist has a readership of around 100,000 people a month, but they're not a traditional media source by any stretch of the imagination. They have barely any office space. They have very few full-time staff. But that being said, they have broken some very big key municipal stories. They're working on creating more provincial issues. So first of all, who defines the media? I think that's important because it goes back to what we said in our opening statement, which is the media has typically shied away from going after personal issues, right? Specifically with Canadians, there are very few personal issues that are considered on the table or acceptable in terms of these things. The only time we get into it are when they involve illegal conduct like drugs or like strippers, or I guess strippers aren't illegal, unless like you do drugs and strippers, anyways. So I think that, but then it defines who decides what's acceptable, right? Like who decides what is on the table and what isn't. And as you get into what Adrian just said in terms of what is a sexy story, the bar is going to, I feel like, and that's sort of what I'm fearing, is that the bar is going to continue to be lowered by people who aren't in the media, but who are still now media. And that's where we're sort of going, is like a lowering of the bar in terms of what's going to happen there. And Adrian also brought up a really good point in terms of investigative journalism. I think one of the stories was the New York Times just spent $250,000 on a 3 or 5 year report. I obviously did not memorize the facts here, but it was a 3 to 5 year report. They spent upwards of $250,000 breaking a story about genetically modified food and organisms. But that's the kind of stuff in terms of like, that's not a scandal, right? It should have been, but it's not sexy. People don't necessarily care about it, and that's the kind of stuff where that's the serious reporting that we need, but it's not creating the eyeballs that Adrian talked about, and that's sort of the problem that we're having.
Does any of the panelists have a thought on how do we create an environment where there is more investigative journalism, or how do you promote, is there anything you can do for that, or is it just hopeless and we can just pray for it?
Well, the situation is a bit dismal, isn't it? I mean, you know, circulation has been plummeting for all the newspapers, right? One of our main sources of good investigative, hard-hitting journalism, traditionally, the CBC, has been axed, and well, you can speak to this more than anybody probably, has been chopped and chopped and chopped. And it's not the conservatives, right? This started fundamentally under the liberals. During Jean Chrétien's prime ministership. I mean, if you look at the decline in money given by Parliament to the CBC, I mean, it's astounding. So as a result, the CBC and other, you know, broadcast and print outlets have all decreased the number of correspondents posted around the country and internationally as well. I mean, international news is really becoming horrendously awful for Canada. And you know, these are all the reasons, right? I mean, it's money. You need money.
Yeah. Great. We'll move on to our next question here. So I'll start with your preamble.
Can I just have like a really quick idea?
Sure.
There's a book by Robert McChesney and John Nichols called The Death and Life of American Journalism. And one of their ideas is to start a foundation that would be financed by ordinary people, a foundation that would be dedicated to encouraging investigative journalism. So that, you know, ordinary people could donate $5. So if this is something that you value, if this is something that you think is necessary for the culture, then perhaps you might, you know, donate some funds for it. And that's an idea that perhaps might have its day in this country at some point. Mm-hmm.
Really quick,
Taylor. Yeah, I just want to admit, I had a really cool conversation with I was at Queensland Parliament last week, and Kevin Page was one of the guest speakers, and I had the amazing opportunity to talk to him that night, and one of the things that he brought up that I think most stuck in my mind was he said that we have the internet, we have all these tools, and we have all the ability to give people the power to look up stuff, except for the government. The government is so far behind on open information. And I think when we're talking about, like, giving people like more access to investigative journalism, if we're going to let loose, like if we recognize that we're in the digital age and we have this huge mass of people who can do this kind of stuff just even in their spare time, I think the government has to get up in terms of bringing itself up to date in terms of access to digital information law, openness to transparency, because if you give citizens the ability to be journalists, I think that they can do wonders. We're just not there yet.
Can I make one final point? No, it's just a personal example, because it's important that people realize that journalists do have agency, right? And journalists are making decisions and exercising judgment each and every day. Last week, I was doing the 7 o'clock news. I do the 7 o'clock news 4 days a week on radio. And I had to decide, I had to drop one story. And I had to decide between dropping a Rob Ford story or dropping a story about a pig virus that's been emerging in southwestern Ontario, in Middlesex County. And I had to think, okay, and I had about 10 seconds to figure out which one I was gonna drop so that I could fit the time. It's a 4.5 minute newscast. So which one do you think I decided to drop? What would you drop?
Yeah,
I dropped Rob Ford.
Yeah.
And the reason why I dropped Rob Ford. No, but the reason why I dropped Rob Ford was because my job as a journalist is to be a kind of an advocate for the listener, right? Like, that's my job. My job is to represent the viewer or the listener. So I thought it was in the public's interest to hear about the pig virus more than I was hear about Rob Ford, because we've been hearing about Rob Ford every single day. We do way too much coverage of Rob Ford. So, you know, I'm sure some of you in the future will be our journalists, right? And you will have to kind of exercise that kind of judgment as well as to what constitutes, what constitutes news. Because we make the news. Mm-hmm. We actually decide what is the news.
Mm-hmm. It's a good story.
It's good. Thanks so much.
Okay, I'll start with the preamble for the next question here. It's on crisis management. Given that we live in the age of social media and the ever-shrinking world, political scandal news can become a hot and trending topic faster than ever before. In an effort to respond and address criticism, politicians are forced to adopt a range of crisis management strategies to salvage their political images. From smothering the issue and staying tight-lipped about the issue, to getting in front of the story and presenting oneself as the primary source of information on the issue. Get into the question here. In consideration of how quickly political scandal circulates within the Canadian public, how has crisis management on the part of politicians been forced to respond? Is it better to smother the issue or adopt the sunshine strategy of being open and honest with the public? How does crisis management strategy chosen affect overall public trust in the political system? And we're going to start actually with Adrian.
Well, I'm going to take a position that might seem a little bit odd, but I actually think that sometimes it's in the interest of the politician to lie.
Wow.
And that's because lying works. Lying actually works. And it's worked over and over and over again. And we don't know how many times lying has worked. We only know maybe 40 or 50 years later when these documents are declassified. Right? We find out that, wow, there really was a conspiracy to do such and such. Or, wow, such and such. Do you hear what I'm getting at? Like, sometimes, if I were an advisor, right, and I was just concerned about practical matters, I would tell the guy to lie, because it might work, and it might just work.
Yep. So I can I respond?
Yeah.
So you know, I think I would disagree with that, and you know, the famous line I would say in response to that is, I did not have sex with that woman.
Sexual relations,
right. So I don't think lying works. I think on the contrary, and in fact, this is what some people call the second order scandal. And that is, one of the things we're waiting for Rob Ford to do is to lie again or trip up again about something he's claimed to be cured of, like his drinking or his cocaine addiction. So. It's really the media, I think, Adrian's right, the media have run the course of the story on Rob Ford, and they're looking for a new angle. And the new angle comes from when they lie. And I think that's a mistake. Bill Clinton is an example. I mean, Kathleen Dunderdale, she didn't lie, but she, as you know, she was the Premier of Newfoundland and Labrador and resigned recently, and in part one of the reasons she resigned was because she didn't respond to the crisis of the blackout on the island. And I think information abhors a vacuum. So if I was counseling a politician, I would say, don't lie, come out and start talking and be open and transparent. Here's another case. Francis Fox in 1976 was the Solicitor General, was the chief cop in Canada. Very energetic, charismatic, young, up-and-coming liberal. And he stood up spontaneously one day in the House of Commons and said, I'm resigning because I had forged a note for my girlfriend's abortion. And the House was shocked. No one said anything. I mean, there's a whole bunch of crazy things about that, that he would do it, and that at that time, females required a male for an abortion. But he resigned, and he lived to fight another day. He became cabinet minister again in 2 years. He quelled the rumor and the scandal very quickly and nipped it in the bud, and that was the end of it. So I think transparency and openness and coming ahead of the story and framing, and I'm sure Elizabeth will have something to say about framing, is really important to how you respond to a scandal. Sorry.
No, that's perfect.
Taylor, yeah.
Yeah, I'm actually going to jump right on the framing point. I think one of the reasons that being open and honest is something that we're going to have to, I think that we're going to see shift much more into the mainstream for a couple reasons. First of all, I think that the people who are going to be framing things now, it's not just the media, but it's how it's framed on social media. It's how it's framed when people see the story and then share it. It's that knee-jerk reaction of, okay, what do I know about this person, and how am I going to respond to this, and how am I going to filter the information to my friends, right? And that's a big thing, because I think one of the reasons that Justin Trudeau got off a lot easier than anyone else would have for a lot of the things that he's done this year is because he established a narrative of being open, of being honest, and saying, I'm not perfect. And this goes back to what I said in my opening statement in terms of politicians typically building themselves up as being more than human, as being extraordinary, right? But in reality, politicians are just like us, or at least you'd hope they are, in terms of their tendency to make moral, is sometimes immoral, or just like their tendency to make mistakes, right? And opening yourself up to that and saying, yes, I can make mistakes, and yes, this is something that could have happened, I could have been wrong. I think establishing that narrative plays it really big, and it's going to increasingly play into how the story plays out in people's minds, because it's all about where you come from and how you perceive the information in the 2 minutes that you interact with it. And I think that's one of the reasons that Justin Trudeau has been successful. I think it's one of the reasons that he's probably going to continue to be successful, or at least will continue to get a longer honeymoon. And I think that's going to be increasingly the norm in sort of PR.
Great. Professor
Goodyear-Grant? I actually believe, so the question is set up in such a way for you to sort of picture yourself as a politician whose incentives is to retain public office or get reelected at some point in the future. And a good advisor has one job, to help you do that. So I would agree with Adrian, actually, that there are lots of times, depending on the context, where the political decision I would suggest would be to deny, 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 right? I mean, it's all about calculated risk, isn't it? I mean, politics, maybe we wish that politicians would be open, honest, transparent, etc. But they're not, right? They're people just like us, and we're not all open and honest in our lives. So the calculation of risk is the key factor here. How likely is it that independent incriminating evidence is likely to come forward? If that probability is low, then that could be a case where the politician should just, lie and deny. Now, of course, there's going to be lots of situations where it's wise to admit to the actions one's accused of. And I would say, actually, that the kinds of situations where this could be particularly useful is in situations involving personal vice, like adultery, drug use, and so on. And which is why we see politicians like Justin Trudeau and Barack Obama and others saying, yeah, I smoked weed, okay, you got me, type thing. Although I disagree with you that it's really helped Trudeau's image, or it's because of his honesty and openness that he's sort of got away with this, that he's got an easy ride. I think the greater explanation lies in the fact that Trudeau is young, good-looking, energetic, and lives in the shadow of a man who broke every rule.
That's a good point.
So we'll open it up for some discussion for 2 minutes, if anyone wanted to.
And that's actually an interesting point with not only our perception of leaders, but our perception of scandal. We want to have a kind of consistency between our cognitive ideas, what we think of someone, and our emotional affect towards them. So, as Elizabeth just said, Justin Trudeau is a handsome, young, charismatic guy, and we have certain feelings about him, which we read into what we know about him. And the same can be said for Rob Ford. I mean, Rob Ford looks like a bumbling doofus. And that's part of the reason why he gets himself in trouble. There are lots of business leaders, I have no doubt, who are addicted to cocaine, maybe not crack. But
yeah,
it's
stop saying cocaine, it's crack.
Crack.
It's crack.
So
it's not the same thing.
Really? Tell me more, Professor. I think there is this, the issue is about framing. And in scandal, so this question is really around how you get ahead of the story. And I think framing is the way you do that. We have two different kinds of opinions. One is you lie, and you kind of protect your leader. And I'm suggesting you don't lie and you nip the story in the bud.
Just for the record, like, I don't believe in lying.
I'm
not an advocate of lying, but I just wanted to.
Right.
But assuming you're a political advisor and you have one job.
Well, your one job is to kill the story. And I think the way you kill the story is you come out immediately. Can you imagine if Rob Ford immediately, when that story broke, said, there's been some claims that have been made about my personal behavior. I'm going to take a month off, but I'll be back. That would be the end of the story. Come back a month, and he could lie then and say, yeah, I'm rehabilitated. Well, I mean, the point here is he's admitting the transgression immediately. And I think that's important.
He's admitting which transgression immediately?
He
spent the whole summer denying, right?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Originally, if he didn't deny and came out and acknowledged it,
the story
wouldn't have legs.
I don't know.
The reason why, and watch when Parliament resumes, the opposition will try to make more of the Senate scandal, but there's nothing there. There's no news story. I mean, you can only hear Tom Mulcair go on so many times about how, when did Prime Minister Harper know? And did he have knowledge? Unless there's new knowledge, the story dies. And I think the Prime Minister is wise to introduce the budget because it changes the narrative completely. So that's another way. And of course, Rob Ford is changing the narrative by talking about him being the only fiscal conservative who's interested in taxpayers' money.
Great, we'll get on to the next question, and the preamble does have to do with cocaine. Sorry, crack. Many politicians have used scandal to their advantage by claiming that they have learned from their mistakes and have found their way again. In a story that rings close to home, former Washington, D.C. Mayor Marion Barry famously overcame the epitome of political scandal. Mayor Barry, following 3 terms in office, was arrested in 1990 and convicted on perjury and drug charges. Captured all on a very public surveillance video of the mayor smoking crack cocaine. Yet the most shocking aspect of Mayor Barry's story is the fact that following his release from prison in 1992, he ran for office a fourth time in 1994, and he won. Yet this is certainly not true of all political figures whose images are marred by scandal. Those that attempt to make a comeback, however, rely on their ability to create a sense of renewal and finding the light. So, question is, does the public buy this? How forgiving is the Canadian public with respect to political scandals? What factors affect the public's willingness to forgive? I'm going to start with Goodyear-Grant.
Okay, thanks. How willing is the public to forgive? I mean, it's kind of difficult to say, right? Because most people who confront scandal or corruption disappear from public life and don't attempt to re-enter. But of the cases that we know, we have lots of examples of the public being forgiving, and I think to take it to more broad terms, I think there's a couple of factors that affect whether a political career can be salvaged or whether a public can move on. First of all, I think the nature of the scandal is a big factor. In fact, probably the primary factor, right? So again, I'm going to go back to my distinction between corruption and other types of personal or moral scandal, right? Like, I think a sex scandal that doesn't really have much to do with how a person conducts him or herself on the job can probably be more easily, quote, forgiven than somebody, you know, accepting kickbacks from a company in exchange for a tender, right? So does the scandal relate directly to your actions in office? I think that could be a key factor. And we've seen again and again instances where politicians, especially some of the most famous examples from the U.S. have been, quote, forgiven. In fact, their approval has increased after personal scandal. You know, Bill Clinton is probably the most famous example, but there are lots of others. Also, if we look at other countries like France and Italy and so on, these types of, quote, scandals, I mean, are not damaging to political careers at all. So the nature of the scandal has a lot to do with it. I think, too, the timing of the scandal also plays a big role, right? So does a scandal occur close to an election? So proximity to an election is going to be a big factor. You know, is an election 3 or 4 years off, or is it in 6 months' time? The public is famously forgiving, given enough time.
Thank you. Taylor?
I definitely echo something that I believe Professor Rose said, which is it's not necessarily the scandal that'll get you, it's the cover-up. And I think that's kind of one of the interesting things. One of the best examples I can think of is the Chris Christie thing recently in the United States. And one of my favorite articles to come out around that was actually from The Onion, where they nailed it and basically said, Americans horrified at how poorly Chris Christie covered up bridge scandal. And I think that sort of speaks to it in terms of the sort of the attitudes in terms of it's if you do on some levels, and I guess I would build this off of what Goodyear-Grant just said in terms of the types of scandals, but on a lot of things, I think it has to do with how you confront it and the narrative you use in confronting it. And again, Professor Rose said about Rob Ford is a good example, because if Rob Ford had come out within the first 2 weeks of this and said, I have this personal problem, it's deeply troubling, I'm going to step back for 6 months, I'll be back to save the taxpayers of Toronto a lot of money. That would have been a very different story than him denying it for 3 months and then it coming out that there was a video, right? Because suddenly, like the professor said, the story is not necessarily the scandal itself, but his cover-up and his dishonesty to the public. Because there's a difference between screwing up and screwing up and then being dishonest about it. And I think that's sort of one of the big things there in terms of how we deal with it.
AJ?
I think much depends on the politician's charisma, and also much depends on the politician's rootedness in the community from which he or she comes. Marion Barry, as many of you know, was very prominent in the civil rights movement. He had been a student leader, part of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. He had a very, very strong base within the black community, and that scandal was seen as, there was a race-class dynamic with that scandal as well. So that many black people in Washington, D.C. saw Marion Barry as being a victim, right? Because they felt as if the powers that be, the police, were out to get him. So it was the white man going after the black man, right? And Washington, D.C. is a predominantly black city. So in supporting Marion Barry, it was akin to the reaction amongst many African Americans with the whole O.J. Simpson case. Right? It wasn't really just about OJ, right? It was about the history of race relations in the United States. So that was an aspect of it. Another element is whether or not the politician has a kind of folk hero status. So for example, René Lévesque, towards the end of his career, had a number of pretty major transgressions. Like he killed somebody, right? René Lévesque killed somebody in a car accident. And he was never, he didn't end up going to jail for it. And he was forgiven by the public. And he was forgiven because he was seen as being someone who had represented the people well. He was someone who was loved. He was one of the most beloved political figures, really, in Canadian history. Right? Like René Lévesque was rooted in the community in a way that many other, in a way that Pierre Trudeau wasn't. Pierre Trudeau wasn't beloved the way René Lévesque was. And so René Lévesque was able to survive that particular scandal that he faced. Those are just two kind of examples of the importance of charisma and the importance of community as well.
Thank you. Professor Rose?
Yeah, those are great points. I mean, I just wanted to pick up on a couple of them. I mean, I really like your point about the personal capital of a leader being an important variable about how a scandal is determined. I think that's absolutely right. And, you know, we've been circling this, but the idea of scandal as proxy, which is what I think you're getting at, is really at the heart of what we've been talking about tonight. And it's really about what offends us is that these individuals violate the rule of law and that they are seen as above the law or they're seen as somehow different. And that these scandals, whatever they are, stand for some bigger issue, whether it's not paying taxes, whether it's stealing, whether it's infidelity or whether it's drugs. But in addition to those, I think I might add a couple other variables about what affects our reception of scandal. And one is the motivation. So is the motivation to do this scandal activity altruistic or not? And you might say, what's a non-altruistic scandal? And I'm thinking of Oliver North and the Iran-Contra scandal. Oliver North said, yeah, I did it. I sold arms to the Contras. That was against the law. But I did it because I believe it was good for the United States. So there's no personal gain. There was some altruistic goal. And I think largely because of that, there was an acknowledgement he broke the law, that he evaded that. In addition to that, I would also put in our sort of the freedom to act. And I'm thinking of the 1984 debate when John Turner famously said about stacking the Senate, "I had no option." And he said that because this was being, he was being hoisted on that petard, but he had nothing to do with it. He didn't have the freedom to act. So that scandal became much less salient in the eyes of voters because we can't hold him for something that he clearly didn't have an option to do or that he was trying to tell us he didn't.
Great. So we'll open up for two more minutes and then we want to bring the audience in for questions. So we'll just have a kind of quick follow-up discussion. Does anyone want to start us off? I'll do it. So you talked about a couple factors that that might influence the public's perception of the willingness to forgive. One of them was race, and then the other one was kind of talking about the nature of the scandal. So what I've wanted to ask this question all night. I always think of Bill and Hillary Clinton. I always think, how would I, you know, treat each one differently in respect to if they're involved in the same scandal? So I'm just curious about gender. What role do you think that plays? Are we more or less forgiving? And then, so I'm just curious what the panel thinks about that. So whoever wants to take that up. Professor Goodyear-Grant.
I might have something to say about that.
She wrote the book.
I wrote a book. Yeah. I mean, so, you know, media, oh God, this is such a big idea. You know? I mean, media are a reflection of society. So to the extent, and not just coverage of it, but, you know, the way that we, as citizens, judge. Of course we have different standards for women as we do for men in issues related to corruption and scandal, especially on some of the key things that we've been talking about tonight, right? So things like sex scandals, drug use, alcohol abuse, of course we have different standards, right? I mean, throughout history, women have been held and continue to be held to different ethical standards, often higher ethical standards. I mean, one only need to look at coverage of women like Belinda Stronach to know that this would be covered differently, right? So, she was never, unfaithful, but yet her media coverage constantly scrutinized her dating life, her love life. Actually, there was infidelity sort of involved there when she was named her name appeared in, was it Ty Domi's divorce papers or something? Yeah, like she was basically sort of labeled as the homewrecker in the divorce. And so this, actually that didn't get as much coverage as you would have thought it would have, or as I would have thought it would. But, over and over I would say yes. I mean, women would be held to a different standard. And Hillary Clinton would be held to a different standard. I mean, media have a particular, throughout, you know, her time in the public eye, media seem to have had a particular hatred for Hillary Clinton. She has, like, barely ever gotten an inch of space, right? I mean, she's a bitch. She's a ball buster. Or on the other side, she's the sad sack wife who stood by her man or whatever. And as Secretary of State, she was a wildly successful Secretary of State. I mean, she never got her due, in my opinion. And it looks like she may throw her hat in the ring for more. Contesting the nomination for the next presidential election. So,
a really good example, I think, is the former Australian Prime Minister, Julia Gillard.
Yes, absolutely.
And her contest with Tony Abbott. And that is extraordinary speech. I'm not sure if any of you have seen it, but that extraordinary speech that she gave in the House of Commons, it was an extemporaneous speech that went on for about 18 minutes in which she just eviscerated what she regarded as being the endemic sexism. Mm-hmm. Not just within the Abbott's party. I'm just forgetting the name. It's a conservative party. The conservatives. But I'm saying the entire political scene in Australia. Like, she took everyone to task, and that was it was a very personal. There was a kind of a visceral aspect to that speech that really is worth paying attention to, because she was responding to the fact that she felt there was a double standard in Australian politics, and that she'd been treated very differently than a man would have. And even, for example, her relationship with her husband, I think her husband is a hairstylist, and his sexuality had come into question. You know, there were questions.
Well, reporters continuously asked her if her husband was
gay.
Which is
kind of an extraordinary thing, too.
Although Australian media, I mean, seems to me like a whole new level of no holds barred, right? I mean, Aussie media.
With Eugenie Bouchard and asking whether she has a boyfriend or something.
Yeah, exactly.
I was just going to say, the other really interesting part about that, too, is then how the media, like, how the media, again, then reflected on that, because it actually became, in a lot of areas of Australian media, it became a scandal that she lashed out in the House of Commons. She wasn't seen as being, if a male speech, if someone of the opposite sex had given a speech of similar passion attacking someone for, let's say, racism or something that not to do with gender, it would have been deemed most likely as something that would have been ballsy or like very courageous or that kind of stuff. She was deemed by a lot of the Australian media to have been a bitch in the House of Commons, which is, and that just plays into just how the narrative goes, and in terms of it was actually played in their media as a big scandal, and it actually turned into this whole like, well, she's just trying to turn the page on their economic thing, and it actually turned into a huge narrative in the election, that speech, which is kind of interesting how that plays.
Much. So now we're going to bring the audience in. So if you guys have questions on any of the topics, yeah, just raise your hand and I'll call on you. Yeah, at the back there.
I just wanted to kind of put a quick question by my mention points. First of all, Adrian's point of kind of crowdsourcing and investigative journalism, and then Taylor's point of kind of how do we define the media. I'm sure a lot of people are aware of Gawker, and more specifically, the crack starter campaign launched, but they tried to crowdsource the Gawker crack. A lot of people call this witch hunting and down hunting. I just was kind of asking if you think this is ethical to kind of go after them in such a perfect way.
I don't have a problem with that, personally. I think that we want people to become more engaged in the political arena. And in fact, one of the problems I had with Jeffrey Simpson's article was that he kind of approached politics as being a spectator sport, right? So it was almost as if we're watching our political elites do politics for us, right? And our job is to applaud, our job as citizens is to applaud and boo at the right moments, at the appropriate moments. And I think that what this crowdsourcing tool, I suppose, allows people to do is to pursue stories that they're interested in. I have no problem with that pursuit. Personally.
Yeah, I was also going to say, I have, not to bypass the question, but I have a bigger problem with the premise, which is buying sources of scandal. I think that's one, and I think the interesting concept there is that the Toronto Star got the offer before Gawker to sell, or actually, sorry, I should say, both outlets got the offer to buy the videotape. Toronto Star said no. Gawker said, well, we don't have the money, but we'd like to, so we're going to start this crackstar campaign. And I think that's a really interesting divide between them, because the Toronto Star took a very, like, you can raise a lot of qualms with the Toronto Star and the reporting, but I think the interesting ethical stand that they took there was that they wouldn't pay for a source, even though it would have been huge, and it would have rocketed them, and it probably could have forced them to resign. They wouldn't pay for a source. And I think that's one of the interesting things there in terms of what should we as citizens expect in terms of our access to information, but also what are we willing to give for it? Because you can say innocuously, like, yeah, they should have paid for that one. But then what about the next one? Like, what about the next person who says, I have information on this cabinet minister who did X, I want $10,000 for you to give me that, for me to hand over that information to you. Where do you draw that line, right? And I think that's the interesting component of that question as well, as sort of we go forward.
That's a good point too. Once we start paying for information in this kind of case, the information itself, you know, its credibility can come into question, right? Because people would have incentives then to fabricate information in order to for financial reward. But in the case that you're describing, the Gawker one, I mean, well, it was hardly surprising, right? I mean, it's Gawker, right? I don't have a big problem with it either, though. I mean, I don't. I mean, and also, did Toronto Star say, no, we're not paying for a source? Or is it the case that Toronto Star couldn't pay?
Yeah,
right? Could they actually pay for it? I don't know.
Yeah, you'll remember the second video, the second crack video that the Star broke of him dancing in his, not dancing, of him in his house. They did pay for that. So I think it's, as Elizabeth said, just a question of the
pacing
cost.
The pacing rant.
They paid $5,000 for that.
So maybe their price is just a lot lower than what was being asked.
Interesting.
I don't know what Canadian newspapers could afford to pay for information. I don't imagine it's $50,000.
Okay, so just ask the grassy question from the back to really project your voice. The microphone's way down here. It'd be good to hear you. Yeah, right at the back there.
So Neil Levitt wrote a book called The Decline of Deference, and he basically argued that Canadians now have become less deferent over time. So I just wanted to say, A, do you agree with the assumption that the Canadian public is becoming less deferent? And if so, what effect will this have with regards to how accepting we are? This question number four talks about forgiving public scandals. We talk about Conrad Black and how he had to go to the States to get arrested. Do you believe that deference towards authority that now allegedly, according to Neil Levitt, is decreasing, do you think that will change? And will that make our generation less forgiving towards political scandals than our parents?
Anyone can take that?
Yeah, I want to answer that in a, yes, I agree with Nevitt's decline of deference thesis, and I think that you're right that the next generation will be less deferential, but what the question asks, I think, which is really interesting, is national differences, which we've sort of touched on. When the Japanese tsunami hit Japan in 2011, it was a scandal. And it was a scandal not because they were embarrassed as we were about our mayor. It was a scandal not because they were ashamed about behavior, but it was a scandal because they felt shame. And the role of political culture, national values, national attitudes, we talked about Australia a little bit, I think is really important in what in how we perceive scandals. So what is a scandal here may not be a scandal elsewhere. The other famous example is the French example where, what was the prime minister who brought whose mistress went to his funeral?
Mitterrand,
right. François Mitterrand's mistress went to his funeral, and that was not seen as scandalous. So I think there are parameters around which scandal is perceived, and that is sort of defined by this national culture.
I think that it's an interesting point. So your cohort and the one before you, and you know, so cohorts are getting progressively more self-directing in politics, less deferential to authority, as you say. So that may make them less forgiving of political scandal and you know, create higher expectations for behavior in office. On the other side, though, your generation, and as the generations come through, are becoming more socially liberal. So for certain types of scandal, you may become more tolerant. So things like drug use, sex scandals, whatever, you know, less socially conservative, less prudish than, you know, grandparents and great-grandparents. And so forgiveness may actually become more forthcoming. So it's hard to say, right? It depends which types of values get triggered when the time to forgive comes upon you.
Great. Yeah, we'll take lots more questions right
in the front. I have a question specifically for you, Adrian. At first, you talked about how we potentially might need to know more about the private lives of politicians, but later we talked about kind of the sensationalism and needing more investigative journalism. So I guess I have a two-pronged question. First of all, is a politician less entitled to privacy than we are, and like than the average citizen? And second of all, where do you strike the balance between sort of a sensationalism of the private life of a politician with maybe like a more serious sort of investigative journalism, or is it investigating into the private lives, or you know, what's the balance there?
Yeah. First of all, I think politicians deserve to have a private life, and I think that you know, certain elements of that private life have to be respected, particularly with regard to children. I think particularly with regard to perhaps one's spouse, parents. I think that there are certain instances, though, where it is germane, like it is relevant to a story to delve into the person's personal life, particularly when that has public policy, there's a kind of public policy consequence, shall I say, to it. Like, for example, the Rob Ford case. He is someone who has been very much concerned about law and order, right? In a previous life, he talked about sending drug dealers, you know, to jail and you know, locking them up and throwing away the key. So if that's your political stance that you're taking, and then you are found to be, you know, engaging in the same kind of behavior, and that's a personal problem. Like I don't think one should criticize a person for having a substance abuse problem because it's an addiction, right? But I think in that instance, there is relevance to the public. I think the public deserves to know about what Rob Ford does in his private life as it pertains to drugs because of the very overt position that he took. So I think it really depends on what. I'm not a big advocate of playing up sex scandals in any kind of way. Like, that's not something of interest to me. When I was talking about the need to have more scandal coverage, I was talking about the need to get at the root of things, right? Like I was talking about more, that word, what the word radical means, getting to the root of things. So it was more that approach, that we need to have more of these kinds of stories that expose or that bring light to areas of darkness in our society. And that's not necessarily focusing on the personal, it's focusing on, for example, the scandal that is the condition of a lot of First Nations people, Indigenous people in this country. We don't have enough stories about that, really, right? We don't have dedicated reporters who focus on Aboriginal issues in this country. That's a scandal in and of itself. There are a lot more stories that need to be told. There are a lot more Attawapiskats out there, right, that we don't know about. We know that one word, but we don't know other Attawapiskats. We need to know more. So that's what I was kind of getting at.
Yeah, kind of going off of what Lucia was saying about sensationalism, I'm curious to know what the panel thinks about media programs such as House of Cards or The Newsroom in terms of, the media's role in the political lives and sensationalizing, the political scandal and whatnot. Anyway.
Well, I think just picking up on that question and the previous one, I think the media have an obligation to investigate the personal lives of politicians if there's something hypocritical about it. And I think that's what Adrian was getting at. So a homophobic preacher or politician like Larry Craig, for example, Senator Larry Craig of Idaho, who condemns gay marriage and homosexuality and then is caught cruising in an airport washroom picking up guys, is a story. It's a scandal, not because of his behavior, but what it says about his hypocrisy. So, I think we have to separate the act, smoking crack, having sex, whatever it is, from the bigger picture of how it relates to who you are. So I think it's the hypocrisy. And I'm totally drawing a blank, but I can remember his boat, the American presidential candidate.
Gary Hart.
Thank you. Gary Hart, whose boat was Monkey Business. And he said, and he was known to have affairs. And the media said, Gary, you're about to run for president. You're known to have affairs. This is going to be a problem. And he said, follow me. And they did. And they found him on a boat called Monkey Business with his girlfriend. So the story there was about hypocrisy. So I think, to answer your question, the media have an obligation to expose it if it's about the behavior of politicians.
That's great. Just looking right there.
Yeah, so I want to draw something that Professor Rosier said in your opening remarks, that kind of all of these scandals have a moral element to them. So the question that often comes up whenever there's a political scandal is, do we hold our politicians, our elected officials, to a higher moral standard than we would the average citizen, and then should we? This just opens up to anyone.
I would say absolutely. I would say that these politicians are supposed to represent the best of us. They're supposed to kind of embody the values that we hold most dear. And so I think it is not, I think it's understandable that people see them as being role models for the society. I think that absolutely they should be held to higher standards.
Taylor, sure.
Yeah, I would also just say that I think one of the reasons that we tend to hold people to a higher standard is because a lot of politicians go into or say that they go into politics for public service and to give back to the public, right? Like a lot of MPs who I talk to say that they do it because they want to serve their constituencies, they want to do right by these things. In a lot of cases, that's why a lot of politicians you know, bygones be bygones, are good people. They want to be in, and they want to be altruistic about what they do, and they want to serve the public. I think that one of the things that brings politicians crashing down to earth is that when we learn that they're as selfish as 99.9% of the rest of the population and are maybe just doing something for themselves instead of serving the public interest. I think that's one of the things. I also think that it has a lot to do with what we said earlier in terms of what constituency you're talking about, right? Like one of the best, one of the stories, one of the many phases in the Rob Ford story has been the fact that his political support has not gone below 35% in polling throughout this entire thing, which is insane. Like, that's actually, like how does that happen, right? But there's actually a good reason for it, and it's because he never sold himself to these people as being anything more than just like them. He never sold himself as being anything more than the average Joe who makes mistakes and he's Rob, right? He's not Mayor Ford, he's Rob. And it also depends on the constituency. And I think that's why typically people are either fringes or either edges of the political spectrum tend to be slightly more forgiving just because they can be a little more like, never mind, I'm just going to shut up because I don't know where I was going with that.
But, you know, if I can just jump in there, I mean, I think one of the great things about this topic is the kind of messiness of the terrain. So thinking about scandal really involves thinking about whether, A, it's a moral transgression or not. B, if the moral transgression is big enough to warrant it being a scandal. Justin, you know, Trudeau admitted to smoking dope. We, you know, say we shrug our shoulders. And C, the relationship of that moral transgression to the job. So if a politician said, you know, I had an affair, maybe we'd shrug our shoulders and say, well, yes, that's a moral transgression. That's bad. It has nothing to do with you being a cabinet minister. You don't need to resign. So the interesting thing for me on this topic is trying to sort out those three areas and figure out how they overlap.
I mean, it kind of depends, too, on which segment of the electorate you're talking about or which particular voter you're talking about, right? Like, so for some people, moral integrity is going to be more salient electorally or in terms of forming your opinion about a politician than other things. For me personally, competence is actually going to be a lot more important than personal moral integrity. Although when we get into things like, you know, blatant hypocrisy around issues like gay rights and so on, I mean, that's going to be a problem because for me that's also a sort of competence issue too, right? But so it depends which factors are prime in people's minds in terms of how they judge politicians, I think.
Smiling gentleman.
Okay, so this is a question that I have for Dr. Goodyear-Grant. One of the things I found really interesting, you mentioned it kind of casually, was the tendency for people who self-select into politics to maybe be more prone to scandal. So I guess, I don't know if this is something you've thought about before and other people can feel free to weigh in,
yeah.
But sort of what's at stake there? What, I guess, you know.
Talk around that? Yeah, I mean, right, it takes us, so I've been thinking a lot about this recently, because I've just started a new project on political recruitment, and the thing I'm most interested in is, at the very initial stage, is that where we start to see the differences, is that what causes gender differences in political representation at the end stages? But it's also caused me to think a lot about the types of people who get recruited or self-select into political careers. And one of the things that occurs to me is definitely the case that it's a certain personality type that will self-select, like gregarious, outgoing, entitled, self-confident, all of these kinds of factors, right? So there's actually really two types. That type is more prevalent, but then there's the sort of public servant, like the classic public servant, who truly does get into it for, you know, community service and the greater public good, or some love of policy, or whatever the case may be. So I think there are certain personality traits that probably predispose people towards different types of scandal. Entitlement is a big one, or sort of, you know, extreme self-confidence. And whether we're talking here about corruption, which I sort of think of as sort of more morally bad than drug use or infidelity or whatever by politicians, these types of traits do sort of tend to lead people more towards that. Especially when you're talking about the sort of US context where, you know, politics has always been very glamorous and has always put Congress people and senators and presidents, you know, sort of in elbow rubbing distance with, you know, movie stars, organized crime, etc. So the temptations have always been there, and I mean, that might be one reason why we see more scandal in the U.S. Yeah, so it's, I don't know that I have reliable knowledge on it yet, but this is definitely my sense, that there's definitely a type that goes into this. And just like there's a type who self-select into like sort of executive management careers, the law, you know, business, medicine, professoring, right?
Okay, well, I think we'll take two more short questions. So, just right there.
Sure. So, when we talk about media tonight, and I guess this question is primarily directed towards Adrian, but I'd be happy for other thoughts as well. We've been talking about sort of populist media, so new media, blogging, and then the way that that uncovers and then relates to the broader population. I'm wondering if you compare that to the celebrity media we see in the States, so the Rush Limbaughs, the Bill O'Reillys, and how they help to uncover or propagate or perhaps drum up scandal, and why there is no appetite or doesn't seem to be an appetite for that type of media in Canada.
You ask easy questions.
Is there no appetite or not sufficient viewing
market
base for advertising dollars, right? Like, I think there would be appetite in Canada for this kind of format.
Yeah.
I mean, we're not less partisan or less interested in scandal or titillation than Americans, are we? I don't think so.
Yeah, Sun News isn't doing that well.
Sun News.
Yeah, that would
Sun,
be a
yeah.
good...
Sun,
yeah.
But part of it might be where it is on the dial. Like, it's a channel. It's not being carried. It's not being carried by all cable network, so that might be a reason why it hasn't been doing well. There's no comparison, really. Like, I'm not sure if this is answering the question, but the amount of money that I think Bill O'Reilly makes, what, $20 million a year? Rush Limbaugh makes about the same, probably. The amount of power that they have within the Republican Party, like particularly the kind of right wing of the Republican Party, I don't think that there's an equivalent in this country. Like, I don't think there's a media figure who would be able to exert that kind of influence over such a substantial demographic. It's really hard. It's a completely different kind of landscape. There's a kind of demagogue. There's a kind of a demagogue aspect, almost like a kind of an Elmer Gantry-esque aspect to some of these folks that they're kind of like televangelists, aren't they? Like, particularly Rush Limbaugh, more so than Bill O'Reilly. Yeah. So I think it's hard to. I'm not sure if I'm answering the question, but it's hard to compare. I can't imagine a similar kind of dynamic happening in this country. Maybe there was a time in Alberta's history, like William Eberhardt, was in the 1930s and 1940s, a social credit premier, was a very charismatic politician, and also had a media presence as well. He's perhaps one person that I can think of who might be somewhat similar to Limbaugh and Bill O'Reilly.
He actually was an evangelist.
Yeah, he was.
Yeah,
he,
exactly.
Yeah, he was an evangelist.
Yeah.
I can't think of too many. I'm trying to think of some other examples of figures like that in Canadian history. I really can't. Well, Tommy Douglas, he didn't have as much of a media presence, but he was, there was a kind of a, was he Baptist or? I think Tommy Douglas was Baptist, and there's a kind of an evangelical aspect to him. I can't think of another kind of figure in Canadian history.
Do any of the panelists want to get in?
I wanted to say, I think one of the interesting differences too is the I don't think, well, first of all, especially if you compare it to the United States, I don't think Canadians are necessarily as divided in terms of being on one end of the spectrum or the other. And I mean, that's backed up by, like, obviously a lot of research and a lot of, like, statistics and that kind of stuff. But I think the other really interesting thing is, and I wish I remembered who I talked to with this, but it was, I was at a wine and cheese just before the holidays, and there was a U of T professor, and she was, I was asking her what her research was on, or she's a PhD student, and she was talking about the differences in how, in communication in Canada, specifically the effect that the French and English divide has. Because basically what she was talking about was how the biggest, if you look at where Canadians sit in the political spectrum and where we would be most partisanly opposed at one end or the other, the biggest difference in terms of region and in terms of political views also happens to coincide in 99% of cases with language. And that's the really interesting part, because Quebec is politically the most atypical in Canada in terms of being much more liberal, and the Maritimes are kind of the middle, and then the big myth obviously is Alberta and Ontario tend to be the closest in terms of political views. But the interesting thing there is that where you might have a big sort of left-right divide in terms of Quebec and the rest of Canada, you have that language barrier, which acts as kind of like which can act as sort of like a buffer in terms of not in terms of toning down the harsh partisan rhetoric, because it would literally get lost in translation. So I think that might be an interesting sort of interplay there. It's unique to Canada.
And I promised one more question. He's my boss, so I'll let him ask it, and then we'll have the reception after. So one more brief question.
Sure, yeah. So just wondering if you guys have an opinion on stereotypes or expectations associated to certain political parties in Canada or in the US, and what role the media would have in potentially framing those expectations. So an example of that would be, for me, like, if I saw the RNC doing something that was in a gray area in terms of ethically sound behavior when it comes to getting elected into office, like, I'd be disappointed, but it wouldn't shock me. That behavior wouldn't shock me, just because they have a long history of that kind of stuff, especially if you look at Watergate and Nixon. So are there certain stereotypes, stereotypical scandals or expectations associated with political parties? And if so, what expectations, how is that framed by the media?
I don't think that there are actually associations of certain types of scandals with certain political colors. Like, I mean, in Canada anyway, the parties have all had their fair share of problems in terms of scandal and corruption. I mean, and we've seen that even over the past few electoral cycles with the Liberals in the 2000s, and then, you know, the Conservatives seem to have been plagued by scandal in the, you know, as we say, over the past 12 months or so. So I don't think there are stereotypes. I mean, there are definitely party stereotypes, but relating to other things other than scandal, right? So, like, you know, the idea that conservative parties are thought to be sounder economic managers and
strong on family values.
Strong. Well, that depends on where you are, you know. And left wing parties are thought to be more compassionate or, you know, closer to organized labor or whatever. But on scandal, I don't think so. The one exception might be the sort of NDP in Canada. I mean, it's always sort of portrayed itself as the party of principle and, you know, might have a more sort of ethical image. But then one would certainly point out that, well, you know, the NDP has never actually held government at the federal level, so hasn't had the opportunity to engage in all sorts of scandal like the other two parties had. So, you know, there's a good reason for maybe why that stereotype exists. But I mean, that's my sense anyway. I haven't given it a lot of thought, but I don't think there are stereotypes.
Yeah, I would agree. I don't think there are stereotypes in Canada, and I think if there are, I mean, I think the media would probably, frame the story in terms of our existing perceptions of the party. So, as you were mentioning, strong fiscal managers for the Conservatives, and maybe more latitude and liberal values for left-wing parties. I'm not sure. But I think this gets at an important point, and that is the way the media frame it is really dependent on our preconceived ideas. So whether it's about parties or leaders or behavior, and Elizabeth talked about this, about types, ideal types, I mean, I think that helps shape the contours of the way the story is revealed.
There's probably a gotcha approach to, and I'm using this colloquial term, nailing Republicans in the States, particularly around moral issues, just because they are the family values party, like, quote unquote, the family values party. So that, like, you know, the Larry Craig, you know, the media is almost gleeful
Schadenfreude. Right. Yeah.
Yeah, because you know he has exposed himself as being what he claims is the worst thing that one can be. That's the one maybe concrete example I can think of.
It's kind of an interesting example too, though, because what it does then in turn is allow Republicans in the U.S. and in some cases in Canada, conservatives to, you know, bolster their arguments about liberal media bias and how they're up. I mean, hasn't this been Rob Ford's sort of, you know, soundtrack his entire time in office? It's the liberal media, in particular the Toronto Star, who were out to get him and were similarly gleeful when he got caught with his pants down, so to speak. Yeah.
That video's coming up next weekend.
What's that? Oh, yes, next weekend. Oh.
No. So the most recent example is that Florida representative, that Florida Republican, first-term Republican, who was just found out to be, I think he's a heroin addict. The only case I'm talking about? It just happened a couple of weeks ago, but he was railing against the the decline of American civilization and the fact that all these people are on drugs, and then it turns out he was doing lines in the bathroom, but he's a first-term Republican. I'm just not remembering his name, but there was a kind of a Schadenfreude with him in particular. Yeah.
Was he doing crack or cocaine?
Has anyone seen the movie
Mitt? Yeah.
Crack.
So Mitt is available on Netflix. Yeah. It just came out on Saturday.
What is it?
Mitt. And it's a hagiography, I would say, of the stereotypes associated with Mitt Romney, filmed over 6 years. It's quite good, and it reinforces the stereotypes that we have, or that Americans have, of Mitt Romney, strong family guy, soft-spoken, Mormon, never swears. He never swears at all in the film. Never raises his voice, gentle and kind. So there's a lot of myth-making that goes on, and when scandals happen, they're played up against the backdrop of our already preconceived ideas of them.
Great. Well, on that, I think we're going to wrap it up. So let's give a round of applause for our panel.
So a big thank you to everybody who came out today, and a big thank you to our panelists and our moderator tonight. It's really appreciated. Just a reminder that we're going to have another two public lectures before the end of this term. We also encourage you all to submit online at politicusjournal.ca any submissions before February 12th. We cover everything under the umbrella of political studies here at Queen's. And actually, Professor Rose and Professor Goodyear-Grant have two of our members on our panel of referees who will be reviewing the submissions. So if you have any questions about that, Michael O'Shell is our student liaison. He'll be more than happy to take down your email and get in contact with you about the whole process, what that looks like. Submissions are due on February 12th at 4 p.m. And you can find out the submission guidelines and timeline online on our website at politicusjournal.ca. So thanks again to everybody coming out, and thanks again to our panelists.